Well, it's untrue. Earl, I was there. I came to the convention hall, all bright-eyed and innocent, and Mort Weisinger was unloading pictures from a car at the curb, and he said, "Will you carry these inside for me?" So I carried these black and white illustrations in to be auctioned off to pay the expense of the convention. And I was there for easily 15 minutes until Willie Sikora saw me. And he came loping across the floor and said, "Get out of here, you're not welcome." Which was true of me and Don Walheim and six or seven others who were tossed out. But it wasn't really all that bad because I spent the whole convention in the bar next door, which was where all the writers were anyhow.
Let me introduce Bob Mayo. To those of you who don't know him, he's one of the most distinguished fans that the Seal has ever had. He goes back even before my time. I'm not sure if he goes back before Fred's time, but they're about equal in seniority. On my way to the MagiCon from Chicago, my buddy Mark Reinsberg, who was the chairman of the second World Science Fiction Convention, and myself, we stopped in Philadelphia and visited with Bob. And as a matter of fact, in those days, we were all so poor that we never had any place to stay, excepting at the home of a fan in any given city that we might come to. So the only way we were able to get to the New York Convention was to impose ourselves cross-country, spending the evening with fans all the way along across the country. Otherwise, we would never have been able to make the trip. Bob lived in Philadelphia in those days. He lives in Bethesda, Maryland now. And he certainly can tell you some wonderful things about MagiCon 1.
Yeah, I well remember the evening that Earl Korshak and Mark Reinsberg drew up to my door. I think it was the night before the convention.
Oh, yes.
You stayed at my house at night, I assume.
Yes, and also at John Baltadonis.
Uh-huh. Well, before we get into the actual what happened at MagiCon 1, I'd like to say a few words of how MagiCon 1 actually came about. To do this, you have to go back to April 1934, when the most momentous incident in the history of science fiction fandom occurred. This was the formation of the Science Fiction League by Hugo Gernsback and Charles D. Hornigan, the editors of Wonder Stories. Through the formation of this organization, various local groups were formed, Science Fiction League chapters. And one of these was the Philadelphia group, and another was the New York group, but
Brooklyn group,
which Fred Pohl was a member. However, there was a split over there with the Wonder Stories, and three members were expelled: Dolly Walheim, William S. Sikora, and John B. Michelle. Probably the only three people ever expelled from a magazine organization in the history of the world. But it was about this time that we received a letter in Philadelphia from, I guess it was William Sikora saying, or Don Walheim saying, the New York group was going to be visiting the Philadelphia group. So about a half a dozen New Yorkers, about a half a dozen Philadelphians. One of the New Yorkers was Fred Pohl, and one of the Philadelphians was me. So two of the 11 people who were at the so-called first convention are sitting at this table.
Not so-called, it was the very first convention.
Well, I was just going to say how it was so cool. We were meeting, we had a little meeting at Bill Rothman's house in Philadelphia, and Donald Walheim got up and said, "Why don't we call this the first convention?" And everybody said, "This is a great idea." And then he said, "I have a further idea. Why don't we plan for a world convention, world science fiction convention, to be held in New York City, in conjunction with the 1939 World's Fair?" Of course, the World's Fair won't know anything about it, but you know, that's immaterial. So what happened, it's a long story, but the New York Convention did occur in 1939. The group that originally thought it up, though, were excluded from attending it. People like Fred Pohl and Don Walheim. And that's basically the way the idea of the first Worldcon occurred.
Bob mentioned the Science Fiction League. I'd like to expand a little bit and explain something about the Science Fiction League. It was run by Wonder Stories. Hugo Gernsback started it because he was panicked at the thought that not every reader bought every issue of Wonder Stories. And he thought he would have to find some way of making sure they never missed an issue. So he started this pen pal club called the Science Fiction League. And everybody who had a dime was able to donate and get his name and address listed in the directory in Wonder Stories. And I joined as soon as I was able to save up the dime, which I became member number 490. And then a year or so later, I wanted to see how they were doing, and I joined again under another name, and I became number 564, and I think I was also number 812. Which, nobody voted for anything in a Gernsback organization, but I was not the only one to do that. Dave Kyle, who's also here and was also one of the future ends who did not quite get to the first Worldcon, lived in a place called Monticello, New York, and the worst thing about Monticello was that it was a fairly small town. There weren't too many other people in it, and hardly any other science fiction readers at all. And along about 1935, Gernsback began chartering individual chapters of the Science Fiction League, one in Brooklyn, which was chapter number one, one in Philadelphia, one in Los Angeles. And Dave thought he would really like to have a chapter of his own. So he joined eight times under eight names and became single-handedly the Syracuse chapter, the Monticello chapter of the Science Fiction League. When the fandom of that time was very much like the fandom of today in that there was an awful lot of competition between various groups and so on, they form and they fall apart. The primary requisite for starting a fan club in New York, and I think also in most of the country, was having a basement. If you had a basement, you could start a book fan club because it would meet there. Chapter number one, the Brooklyn Science Fiction League, originally met in the basement of a man named George Gordon Clark, who was also member number one of the Science Fiction League. When that particular organization fell apart, which was after the first year, the next large group was the East New York Science Fiction League, which met in the basement of a man named Harold W. Kirschenblatt, was then followed by what was called the International Cosmos Science Club, later grandiloquently renamed the International Scientific Association, which met in William Sikora's basement. I don't know what we would have done without basements. And then, as Bob told you, a group of us decided we would come down to Philadelphia and became the first ever convention. As I mentioned the other day to some group, maybe some of you, we actually did some things at that convention. We had some discussions, we passed some resolutions, and all of this was recorded in the minutes. But unfortunately, the minutes got lost, and no one knows what they were. And I know this is so because I was the person who kept those minutes and lost them. That was, conventions were such an obvious good idea that within the next 4 or 5 months, I guess it was, a group in Birmingham, England decided they would have a convention too, and I believe they were the second ever convention.
Can I say one thing?
Just a moment, if you will, Bob, I'm going to pass this over to you. In fact, I'll address the first part of this to you. It seems to me that most of you folks here have heard all this history of these early science fiction conventions, and perhaps what we might do today is to contrast some of the things that happened in 1939 and how differently they are today. The first comment that I'd like to make, and then I'd like to sort of kick this around with the other panelists, the first thing that strikes me is that early conventions had very few ladies. Now, as we look around modern conventions, there's at least 50% of the attendees are ladies. The early conventions,
Certainly, the one they're talking about in 1936 had no ladies at all. The one in 1939, in my recollection, had no ladies except Fred was excluded from the convention, and Fred came with the most charming lady. And I was so upset that Fred was excluded from the convention because I didn't have an opportunity to meet the charming lady that he brought with him, who was excluded also. I'm talking about Leslie Prairie. But before I put that over to Fred, let me give this to Bob. What is your
thought on that?
Well, I just wanted to make a statement in reference to what Fred said. He mentioned David A. Kyle didn't quite make it. Well, it was because David A. Kyle did make it that the others were excluded. Because Moskowitz and Sikora said, okay, let them in. But all of a sudden, a pile of pamphlets about this size were found somewhere on sitting on a chair, and they are titled "Beware of the Dictatorship," etc., etc., etc. And this had been printed by David A. Kyle, who did get in, and all the others were excluded.
Well, Fred, were there any other ladies at the Nikon
one?
I don't know how many of those women were ladies, but there was at least one other female person. She came with Skari Ackerman. Her name was Myrtle Hartlepool, known as Moroyo. And the thing about Moroyo was that she and Bari came in costume, setting the precedent for all the masquerades that have happened since, which was really very interesting because they had no place to change in and out of the costume, so they got up, put them on, wore them all day, and caused quite a stir in the automat when they came over for lunch. I mean, people were looking at these weirdos as they look at all of us now. they were far from as used to it then.
Well,
yeah, just a quick thing to aid our imagination. Where was it held? A hotel, a meeting hall?
It was the Caravan Hall.
Yeah. That was the Baha'i organ.
Was it?
Oh, it was held on in a public meeting hall. Fred seemed to think it was the Baha'i organization. I somehow have the idea that it was some kind of a Slovak hall or something like that.
Well, they had some meetings in Slovak Sokol Hall, but I think that was in Caravan Temple, which I believe was Baha'i.
Well, I think that the critical thing that we should know is that the first convention was held in a hall in which I believe that perhaps they paid $25 or some other moderate fee to us today. The first convention, I think it's a kind of interesting thing, had a very limited program. Even though it was just a hall with one room, of course it could never have accommodated anything that we have today, but it could have accommodated the kind of a program that we had in those days. It was a single track program. And if you didn't like what you were listening to, you got up and went to the bar, but there were no alternatives.
Can you off the microphone a little bit? You're getting a feedback on the microphone.
Thank you. Is this better?
Better.
Good.
About halfway.
Halfway.
About there.
All right.
No, I mean your mouth about there. About 5 inches from the microphone.
Bob, you were going to make a comment.
Was I? Well, let's see, I could make one comment now and say there was one other female at that convention. She was supposed to be a fan, but I always thought she was just a sister hanger-on. That was Gertrude Cuslin.
I think she came to the Chicago convention for the first time.
Was that really?
I believe so. Remember the Trudy Cuslin?
I don't remember her at all.
Well, it seems odd because they said that we can't remember the ladies. There were so few of them. You'd think that they would have, you know, we would all have great memories of them. But as I started this out, Fred brought this very charming lady who was excluded right along with him. Fred.
Thank you, Earl. Bob.
All right. I hate to correct Earl Korshak. But Leslie Prairie was not excluded because she gave a very dynamic and flaming speech on the stage as to why the excluded ones should be let in. I remember that very distinctly. Right, Fred?
You have.
I wasn't there.
Oh.
Yeah, but you were right outside.
It is kind of interesting, though, that, that this schism that, that took, had taken place, and as a matter of fact, largely divided fandom for a short period of time. There were those who thought that this shouldn't be, those who thought that it was outrageous. I think by far the majority of the fans believed that it was an outrageous thing that this exclusion act, exclusion had taken place. And we determined that it would never happen again. At the time of the second convention, when we got the second convention and brought it to Chicago, we certainly had to make it clear to everyone that under no circumstances would any fan, you know, who was a decent person, and by that I mean not somebody who, let's say, was coming in on drugs or something, but any normal, reasonable person would never be excluded from a science fiction convention again.
Just one footnote to the exclusion question. After World War II, a new fan group started in New York. It was called the Hyper Club because it was started by nine fans, myself and Lester Del Rey and Dave Kyle and Jack Gillespie and a few others. Several of us among those who had been thrown out of the first Worldcon. And after we'd been running our club for a while, we decided to put on a con of our own. We had one in 1950, a pretty nice little regional con. And Bill Sikora came around and wanted to come in. And we meditated for a while about whether we should kick him out or not. And we finally let him in, and he began handing out leaflets just as somebody did for the Futurians in the first one. And nobody paid any attention to him at all. And I think maybe they made a big mistake by excluding us because we've been rubbing it in ever since. Incidentally, about 2 months after that convention, I became a professional science fiction magazine editor, and a number of the people who were inside began sucking up to me.
One thing that, that strikes me is that the people who were at that first convention, many of them are still around. There are several of them here at this convention who are not in the room today, or on the panel, they certainly should be. Jack Williamson, as an example. Sam Moskowitz, Sam is giving something, another program at this moment. Dave Kyle is also giving another program. But I think it's rather interesting that the people who were at the first convention stayed on in the field, that once people are bitten by this science fiction fantasy bug, they seem to stay bitten, and here they are 50 years later, still showing up and probably continue to show up until they are no longer able to do so.
Yeah, roughly, how many people attended, and could you name some authors, too?
Sprague DeCamp, Manly Wade Wellman, Frank R. Paul, John Campbell,
Mort Weisinger.
Well, editors, Mort Weisinger.
Charles Harmon.
I'm not sure about Harmon.
Oh,
they're the ones I remember talking
to. Charles Horney was there. I can't think of any of that. I'm sure there must have been other authors.
A lot of fans.
Was Smith there?
No, Smith was not there.
What about Ray Bradbury?
Ray Bradbury. He was there as a fan.
He was there. He hadn't sold anything yet. And as a matter of fact, Ray Bradbury, the story goes, borrowed $50 from Ackerman and took a train across country and carried with him a bunch of illustrations by a friend of his named Hannes Bach. And he went up to Weird Tales office and showed them to him, and they liked them. And within a couple months, Hannes Bach was doing covers for Weird Tales.
Black and white. I don't think he did covers.
Well, maybe it's black and white.
Yeah. There are some pieces by Hannes Bach in the retrospective down in the art show. And if you haven't seen them, please do, because they're gorgeous. Let me get a question while I got the mic. Was it all very serious and constructive back then, or were there some silly spots?
I'd say it was a combination of both. When I first became a science fiction fan, I first joined the Philadelphia Science Fiction Society, it was, let me say this. At that time, in 1935 and 36, in that period, all the fandom revolved around the science fiction magazines. Wonder Stories, Amazing Stories, Astounding Stories, and to some extent, Weird Tales. And the meetings consisted in those early days of discussing the stories that were in the magazines and things of that nature. However, there were a lot of, you call it the silly stuff. Yeah, there were a lot of silly things going on too. I think Fred Pohl can tell you a few of those things that probably happened over with the Brooklyn Science Fiction League.
Well, without getting to that quite yet, let me make let me interject. I think that that in the early conventions, it was my observation that everyone was very intense. We were all a bunch of very intense young people. Later on, we sort of calmed down a little bit. I noticed here at this convention, I've noticed in the last few years of conventions, people are wearing beanies. This is something that we didn't have in the very early conventions, unless I'm mistaken, Fred, but it seems to be after a few conventions, we started to have people wearing beanies as an example.
I think the propeller beanie came along after World War II, because some fan wore one. I think there was some newspaper account which described this as people who wore propeller beanies, and then they became the status symbol. We have just witnessed the entrance of one of the grand old fan of science fiction, Kyle, who ought to be up here with us.
Can't sit there. Come on, Dave.
Come up here, Dave.
Can't sit there.
Come on. Sit up there. You can freeze with the rest of it.
Have you ever forgiven me?
I haven't ever forgiven you for anything, Dave. I don't know what you're talking about specifically. But anyway, Dave has just been charged with being the person who got us all thrown out of the first Worldcon, so now I'll let him tell his side of the story.
Beware of the dictatorship.
What was that remark? Beware of the dictatorship? In the days of the organization of the first Worldcon, a schism developed in the fandom between two rival groups, and the group that I was identified with, that Fred was identified with, the Futurians, were the out-group. And the in-group was running the convention. The in-group considered that the out-group were a bunch of radicals, which maybe they were a bunch of radicals. At any rate, comes convention time, and because my family had a printing press, the power of the printing press, I printed a pamphlet in which I anticipated trouble, that maybe this in-group wouldn't let the out-group have any say in the convention, wouldn't be able to speak and so forth. These pamphlets were printed, little yellow pamphlets called "Beware of the Dictatorship. You come to this science fiction convention, you should be able to be heard, and you should be able to speak, and don't let them railroad things through, and let's let everybody have a voice in this convention." But of course, as the pamphlet said, of course, it'll probably all work out, and democracy will triumph, and we'll have a great time. These scurrilous pamphlets were discovered under a radiator outside the hall where the convention was being held. And the Futurians, Fred Pohl, Don Wahan, Johnny Michelle, Jack Gillespie, Cyril Kornbluth,
a couple of others,
they knew nothing about it, but these pamphlets were discovered as subversive literature. And when Don Wahan showed up, and Fred and so forth, they said, "You're trying to institute revolution and cause trouble and break up the convention. You're not allowed to come in here." And they said, "We don't know anything about it." I kept my mouth shut. I was permitted to go in. Fred and Don Wahan weren't permitted to go in.
And they talk about justice.
But there were many people who were saying, let them come in, even though they're nobodies.
I have to admit that there was a little bit of justice in keeping the Futurians out, because in all honesty, we were a bunch of snotty little bastards. I mean, we thought we knew more than anybody else. Actually, we did, which made it all worse. But we really did rub it in on people like Sikora and Moskowitz and Jimmy Tarasi, who were the ones who were running the affair. And they never forgave us.
As a result, we never played in the ball game.
That's right, you didn't. We never came up to bat.
Well, the odd thing is that as a result of the exclusion, those who were excluded became the, not only were all, with the sympathies of the rest of fandom on their side, we'd never dream of excluding anybody from one of these kind of conventions. And it was, everyone felt it was outrageous that it had taken place. But in addition to that, it is interesting to think that as a result of this, those who did the excluding went into decline. Moskowitz is the only one who, by dint of tremendous effort over many years of contributions to the field, I mean, has remained most active. But the other two members of his group who caused the exclusion shortly went into decline as far as the rest of the science fiction fan world was concerned. And those who were excluded, interestingly, became very famous, many of them as professional writers, artists, and so forth. Hannes Bach, incidentally, who we were speaking about a moment ago, later became one of the Futurians. And there were many other very famous people in that group, that segment.
I'd like to ask you a couple of questions. Who went to the so-called banquet?
Well, I can answer that.
You went, and you went. How much was it?
Somebody asked. The banquet was in honor of Frank R. Paul.
How much?
It was $1 per head, and only about 21 or 22 people, as I recall, were able to make it, come up with a dollar.
I reported it as 30 today.
30? Well,
30 is what
could
I
be
recall.
30.
No? What?
Oh, you mean 30 people?
30 people.
I think you're right, Dave. I
you thought $30?
$30, it would have been zero.
When I was Worldcon chairman in 56, we had an outrageous price of $7, wasn't it?
And I couldn't afford to go.
And we could every time, every year, just when you thought you could be able to afford the banquet cost a little more.
Yeah. I can tell a little incident that occurred at the bank with Jack Agnew and John Balvanis, and I were discussing with Frank R. Paul how we thought he was just about the greatest thing that ever existed. And, you know, it wasn't a sort of soap. We really believed that.
Oh, we did.
And I still do, really, to some extent.
I do. Yes, I do.
And he said that, well, look, would you boys like to have one of my original paintings? Oh, would we like to have one of your, so look, he wrote notes out for the three of us. He says, go up to Hugo Gernsback's office tomorrow and tell him I said to give each of you an original painting. So, oh my God, this is the greatest thing that ever happened to us. So we jumped on the Dickel subway, and the next day we went up and asked to see Mr. Gernsback, and he came out and we told him what had occurred. And Mr. Frank Warpole had said for him to give us paintings. So it was all right. So he went back in his office, and he came out about 5 minutes later and said he had three paintings with him. And he says, I can give you these paintings, but the owner of them says you have to give $10 a piece for them. And we said, $10 a piece? He might as well have asked for $10,000. So this is what happened. We didn't get the paintings after all.
Who is the owner?
Hugo Gernsback.
As a matter of fact, I was looking here on the program, refreshing my memory. Have everyone here received one of these, or if not, they'll come up later and possibly get one? Oh, great. You'll notice on on Tuesday, July the 4th, the first event on that day was the science fiction softball game. I'm only commenting on this because this is the way we used to entertain ourselves in those days. I mean, it was sort of self-entertainment. Today, conventions are largely conducted. Many people, of course, participate in terms of being speakers. I don't mean to suggest that. But in addition to that, in the early conventions, I mean, everybody was really part of it. I mean, was totally, of course, there were so few people there, they had to. But we have a little trouble getting the softball team up. We have I think it was originally planned to be the New Yorkers versus the Philadelphia people. And However, those of us from out of town, there weren't enough New Yorkers and there weren't enough Philadelphians. So I know that Mark Reinsberg and myself and Ray Bradbury played on one of the two teams, I forget which, but we were two of us from Chicago and one from Los Angeles. So in other words, in order to get a softball team together, in order to get 18 players, we had to draw the entire country.
Bob? Any comments about the softball game? Oh, by the way, I think that the score was something like 40 to 27 or something like that.
It wasn't quite that bad. See, what happened originally was that we boys in Philadelphia had an ongoing team, and we were pretty good at it. And we, Tarasi, at one time stated that they knew how to play softball very well. We challenged them to a game. We were known as the PSF as Panthers. I forget what they were known as. And our plan was that our entire team would go to New York. Well, it didn't make it. You know, we had about five of the team that went, and the New York group had about part of their team, as Earl just mentioned. So we drew from the audience at the game, and this doesn't make for a very cohesive team, especially if you draw somebody who's never played softball or something. The New York group got way ahead of the Philadelphia group. It was still called the Philadelphia group, and I think at the middle of the game it was something like 15-2. But in the last few innings, the Philadelphia group began to really get together with it, and the final score was 23-11. And at that point, we challenged the team to another game. They refused.
The business of having softball games stopped, in my memory, after the Chicago convention. The second convention, we also have a softball game. Again, it was one of those ridiculous games with a ridiculous score and a bunch of pretty nebbish players. But after Chicago, I think that was the end of our sportsman-like behavior.
Right. There was an attempt to have a game in Denver, but it didn't materialize.
There was softball in Burflu, El Paso.
And we have a golf course in the events area, in the exhibit area. Golf course.
Worth knowing. Worth avoiding.
What was the total number of people attended, and was there any admission fee?
Total number of people? 200.
Wasn't any admission fee. And the people that attended, it was under 200, so I would guess it was 150.
It says historically 200 is the number that's been used, although, like Dave said, I don't really think there were quite that many.
I think that included everyone's wives who were not even interested in that point in those days, or their mothers and fathers. You know, a lot of us were quite young, sisters and brothers. I mean. The numbers were padded about by families.
I also know I doubt that there was any admission fee, but did you have to be a member of a new fandom or something?
No. Anybody was welcome as long as they were welcome. It was really great, exciting moments, weren't there, Frederick?
I don't know, I was in the bar.
We didn't drink.
It was pretty exciting
days.
In the bar.
In the bar, we didn't have any money to go to bars.
I was in the bar, I sat there with Sprague and Manly Wellman and two or three others for the whole day.
Could you drink?
Yeah, I was 19.
He was 19.
I looked like 30.
I noticed that at these conventions these days that we have a great many films, not only from Hollywood and from other parts of the world. Professionally made films, and even films that are not professionally made, but are very well done. The earliest convention, the New York convention, is an example. The first several conventions never would have a film if it weren't for Forrest Ackerman. Ackerman is on the panel right now, but I notice here, it just recalled to my mind that Ackerman brought us from the coast of Metropolis before he had access to a print of Metropolis, and he brought it with us. With him, if he hadn't brought that film, there would have been no movie.
I think there was another film. I think Lost World.
Oh. No, that was later.
Was that later?
Yeah, they only had the one film, Metropolis. I might mention this, though. Incredibly kick out of this, I think. Later, after the convention was over, Don Wolheim wrote, his impressions of the convention. Well, Don naturally was very negative about it. And he mentioned that the Sikora and Moskowitz, Moskowitz is Jewish, and accused them of supporting the Nazi regime by importing Metropolis, which was a German film.
The way it might be interesting for those of you out there to know how these conventions were funded, the question come up as to how much it cost to come in. Dave had reminded us that it cost nothing. However, there had to be some funds come in, and the way that they principally came in was in terms of what we call the auction. The professional magazines and professional editors were always very good in those days, and gave original paintings, original covers, and so on, to the convention committee to auction off. There was an auction in New York, there was one in Chicago. The first 10 or 15 conventions that I can recall all had an auction. And that was the principal fundraising event. There were memberships, of course, memberships. I don't remember, was there a membership, Dave, like a dollar as a membership, even if you didn't come, like getting a car?
For the first world, for the first con, no.
We had that in Chicago. We charged $1, and you know, people from all over the country joined, some of whom came, some of whom didn't. But the main fundraising thing of the entire convention was the auction, which would bring in, I don't know, maybe $100 or $200 in those very early auctions, and that paid for everything, you know, the hall, the promotion, the publicity, whatever.
As things grew bigger and hotels were being used instead of a rental hall, it was necessary to have some financing, so memberships were being sold ahead of time, but not generally. It was not pushed for membership to be sold ahead of time. I remember in New York, New York Con 1956, those who sent memberships in ahead of time, we felt that was sort of money from heaven, because although we encouraged it, that was not part of the procedure. What you collected on the first day of registration really represented the working capital that you had at the moment. And to show you how inflation takes place, look at the prices today for admission. Nothing in 1939, a dollar in 1940. In 1956, at the Biltmore Hotel in New York, at that time, the going rate for the convention was $2 membership. And I raised the membership, and what a storm of protest. They raised it to $2.50, I guess it was. And everybody said, Yeah, profiteers. Yeah, oh, boy, $2.50. But it steadily went up, as you know. and also, we have various prices now, as you know. But there was only one price then, and it remained the same. Now you have things like supporting membership and attending membership, and do it before this time and do it before that time. Life was much simpler in those days, especially 1939 when it didn't cost anything.
Well, like they said, right now, if you're really fast, you can get a membership for the next convention for the next one, the 1995 convention for $60, I think it is. That's if you're fast and do it immediately. The auctions were discussed. I might mention this. It's interesting to note that original illustrations went for like 25 and 50 cents, and many covers by the top science fiction artists of the day went for like just several dollars or maybe $5. So like Dave just mentioned, getting $100 or $200 took a lot of auctioneering.
In Chicago, when I wore the Ming the Merciless costume, which was a recreation in the opening ceremony, that Ming the Merciless costume, I won a prize. I didn't do the costume, and in fact, I wasn't entitled to the prize, really, because that was made by Fred's first fiancée, Leslie Perry, for the purpose of Donald Walheim wearing it. And Donald, who was, strange to say, conservative type of person, said, in the vernacular of the day, I can't repeat it, but in the vernacular of today, it would be no way would you get me to wear that Ming costume, said Donald Walheim. I said, well, I'll wear it. Now, the Chicago committee gave a prize, and it was a full-color painting from Amazing Stories, West Point 20,065 or something like that.
Right, you still have it?
No, no, somebody talked me out of it. I don't know what happened to it, but it was
It was Ziff Davis anyway.
It was a Ziff Davis cover, and it was a big painting, you know, like that. It was so big that I dragged it around for a couple of conventions and showed it until somebody said, you know, why do you drag that thing around? I'll give you $10 for it or something like that, and it disappeared. And I don't know where it is now, but it was the biggest painting I've ever seen.
Hey, one thing should be pointed out now, the New York Convention in 1939 was a one-shot. It was never considered that there would be other annual conventions. It just happened that it was going to be a convention in New York in 1939.
I think it's Korshak's fault.
I was just going to mention that. It's Korshak's fault. Korshak and Martin Reisberg came from Chicago. They weren't the furthest. Ray Bradbury and Ackerman came, and Royal came from Los Angeles. But the subject came up of having another convention the following year, and the Chicago boys said, yeah, we will bid, and we'll take it. That's about the way it went, was it? We'll take it. And this, and then the following year in Chicago, a couple boys named Lou Martin and Owen F. Wiggins hit the rails from Denver to Chicago. They rode the rails to get there, and they took back the convention in Denver. So you had automatically the rotation system was starting. New York, Chicago, Denver, and then in Denver, the vote was for Los Angeles to be in 1942. However, it did not occur until 1946.
Yeah, I don't think it was Earl. It wasn't you, was it, that headed up the Chicago Convention with Martin?
Yes.
No, it was Mel.
Oh, thank you. The third member of our, this is a little in joke, my middle name is Melvin, and Dave is suggesting that I was a split personality at that point.
I never could figure out whether we were talking to Mel or to Earl.
It depended on if he was selling anything.
That's right. It depended on whether I was buying or selling. The third member, of course, of the Chi-Con committee was Bob Tucker, and another fan that all of you know. So you can see that all these early conventions were put together and done by people who stayed in the field a long time, many of whom became professionals. And that's kind of the history of these science fiction.
Well, you see how it aged me.
The business, though, of convention sites is rather interesting. There wasn't a great deal of bidding, as Bob suggested. Usually, at least in the first couple of conventions, it was pretty much decided that each section of the country should get a convention. And that's why it was New York, Chicago, Denver, and then Los Angeles. After that, it kind of spread around, and people started to bid a little bit. But usually there was very little bidding. Usually some group who wanted to have the convention contacted people they knew who were going to a convention, asked if they would vote for them at the convention, and it was all very unstructured. And
you had a question way in the back. Way in the back. Yeah.
Yes, in the science discussions and seeing the universe, what type of scientific information was new? What kind of stuff did you talk about?
Alchemy. I don't know, I wasn't there.
Yeah, astrology. You'll have to excuse me. I'm doing another.
We did another protest leaflet. We're doing another protest leaflet.
Yeah, doing other protest leaflets. Yeah.
Now, who was there for the science discussions?
Right.
Were you there? Did you hear?
Are you doing
another?
I haven't.
Come on.
Who else? See you at another convention, Dave.
Were you there for the science discussions, Bob? the stuff on the program?
Yeah,
what was it about? What was it about? Question is what it was about.
Well, the only thing I really remember about the program was John W. Campbell's speech, which sort of, you know, certainly talked up, didn't get specific technicalities of science, but it sort of talked about the future of science and this sort of thing. And much of the affair was discussed science fiction, and of course there was a movie, but there wasn't any great extrapolation of science or anything like that.
Well, you got here one program which is science and science fiction, one which is seeing the universe, and one which is science discussions. Did any of them happen?
I don't remember them.
I don't recall them very much either.
If they happened, maybe they weren't very well attended. I don't know. Because, like they say, everybody was always at the bar. Remember that? Where is it? At the bar, you know.
Still true today.
I've heard that pretty much as a sort of a running in joke. Everybody was at the bar. But you know, when you really get down to it, those very early conventions, most of us were really pretty young. We were actually, I think that I myself was possibly 16 or 17 after the MagiCon, and these other gentlemen, I'm sure, were under 20. It seems to me that those early conventions, these gentlemen have a kind of a rosy view of what the world was like. You know, it's like thinking of how it was when you were younger, but I'm not so sure that they were even allowed in the bar. Fred, you keep talking about going to the bar. You were just a tad in those days.
I was 19. I was able to go to the bar. I did more drinking at 19 than I've done ever since.
I think, Fred, that New York was a little more liberal with the bars and other. In fact, New York had an unusual law at the time that a male had to be 21, but a female only had to be 18 to go to a bar.
I put on a dress.
this is based on the idea that 18-year-old girls marry 21-year-old guys or dated them, so they should.
We just the time police tell us we have about 3 minutes left. Is there any 3 minute questions? 2 minute questions.
1 minute. I have a comment.
Yeah.
On the succession, how it became an annual convention. My recollection is that the Chicago boys came to the Philadelphia conference in the fall after the first Worldcon.
You are quite right.
And there asked for endorsement.
You are quite right.
That's right.
Because there wasn't any business meeting at the Worldcon, so there was no occasion for voting on
that's very true.
You were resolution or who was going to put on the next con or what.
That's right.
You're quite right. I'm glad you're here in the audience. basically, what had happened is Reinsberg and I had asked some of the people who were at the NICON, particularly the group who had sponsored it, to support us for Chicago. But we were only getting, in a sense, their independent, individual endorsements. It did require going to the Philly Conference, as they were called in those days, to have a vote to make Chicago official. But I don't know that was done as far as Denver was concerned. I don't think.
We voted on it at Chicago.
Might mention this also, that Philadelphia conference, when Korshak and Reinsberg came to get the endorsement, they brought with them a man resurrected from the grave, Bob Tucker, who had allegedly committed suicide, had allegedly died in a hospital 2 years earlier, and had suddenly came back to life.
But that's a whole other panel, and our time is up. Thank you.
Freezing up here.
This is the coldest hotel you've ever seen.
Three down there. Oh, sure. Well, I'm leaving with my pen.
Bob, who is this gentleman?